Daniel Blackburn is a bond trader who has worked in the financial markets for many years. He used to work in the City of London trading on behalf of big financial institutions, and he now trades independently. We also have other things in common. We've both worked as hen party entertainers, and that's how we first got connected and got to know each other. And you'll hear us share some of our stories and experiences about that. But we also talked a lot about society and the current climate and the state of free speech at the moment in these strange times that we're in. Also, the sponsor of this podcast is the European Hemp Company. Listeners can get £10 off CBD oil as well as free shipping when they use the code BenLarryPodcast at checkout. Just go to europeanhempcompany.co.uk to find out what they've got on offer. As well as that, I'm also a part of a joint venture property investing group, which is based in South Wales. And we've got a mentor called Alex Louise, who coaches us. And if you're interested in finding out more about that or becoming involved yourself, you can go to benlarry.com/Alex, and there's more information there. As well as that, if you're the person who's responsible for paying the bills in your household, you could save money by switching your utilities to Utility Warehouse. Go to benlarry.com/UW and you can very quickly do a price comparison and figure out if they can save you money. And you don't have to fill out loads of paperwork. They do all the switching for you. It's very simple. It's just click, click, click. They can switch you over and you can save monthly on your bills. They have a double the discount price guarantee. So if you do actually find that you could be saving elsewhere, they will reimburse you double the difference. They'll also send somebody in a van to come and replace all the light bulbs in your house with new LED light bulbs for free. No cost, no strings attached, and they'll replace them forever for life. It really is a very interesting offer, kind of a no-brainer. So go and check it out at benlarry.com/UW. If you know anybody else that would make an interesting podcast guest, you can direct them to benlarry.com/podcastguest. And if you're interested in sponsoring this podcast, go to benlarry.com/sponsorship.
How's it going?
Yeah, good, mate. Nice to speak to you.
Yeah, good to speak to you too. You can hear me okay, can't you? There's no interference in the background, is there?
No, perfectly clear, crystal clear.
Okay, that's great.
How are you doing today? So we were chatting recently and it turns out we've got quite a lot in common, it seems.
Yeah, a lot of similar views, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, firstly, we've got a similar outlook on the free market and capitalism and that kind of thing. And also we do similar kind of businesses as well. The reason I know you is from the hen party entertainment industry.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
And so tell us about you then. So you're a stock market trader. So you're an interesting guy. So give us a rundown on how you got into all this stuff.
Basically when I finished uni, I got offered various different jobs. And the one I decided to take was as a bond trader at a proprietary trading firm in London.
Wow.
So that is basically how I got into finance and trading and economics and all that sort of jazz, really.
That's some Gordon Gekko stuff right there, isn't it?
Well, I don't know. I don't know. It's all that it's cracked up to be. It's hard. It's hard work. It's long hours, and it's stressful.
So, what does that actually involve? Because I don't really. I mean, I've got an idea, but most people listening to this won't really know. So, what do you actually have to do for that job?
Okay. Well, for bond trading, I traded government bonds, like European, UK bonds, and. Sort of how we trade them is we trade movements in the yield curve. So we'll trade hedge positions, isolating certain parts of the yield curve. So that's basically what we do. And then to decide on what sort of positions and things to do, with bonds, you have to work out what you think is going to happen with rates and inflation and the economy in general going forwards. So it's quite a fundamentally driven based way of trading, which is because of that, which is why I learned a lot about economics and literally up to date, to the day, economic decisions and things that central bankers say that can affect what they're gonna thinking of doing with rates and inflation expectations and things like that. So it wasn't like there's various different ways of trading. Like there's a different way that I trade now, where I trade more on just on technical analysis, which I find is easier. This sort of bond trading that I used to do was different. It wasn't so much based on technical analysis. It's more based on fundamental analysis.
Yeah, I was gonna ask you that. How much of it was dictated by a set of rules that you were given to trade by, and how much of it was your own determinations about what was going to happen in the market?
Well, everything was based on our own determinations. We would trade our own account based on whatever we wanted to do. Obviously, we had risk managers that would keep a track of our overall risk and our position size and our profit and loss and things like that. But we had pretty much free rein. So you can make, you were there to live and die by your own sword, basically.
That's interesting. So why now? I get the impression you're now doing it for yourself. Are you? Is that what you're doing?
Yeah, I'm doing it for myself. A lot more now recently in the past year or so than I have been over a lot of the past, well, say 10 years. But I have done it in varying sort of intensities over the past, well, literally since I left the hedge fund in London, which was basically 2009 when the financial crisis hit. So it was that point that I went off on my own. So
why do you choose a more technical approach now? Is it like, why is that?
Trading bonds is a lot more, the pricing of bonds is a lot more dictated by what the interest rates for that certain zone are set at. So that is an arbitrarily chosen thing by the central bankers in that zone, and they make decisions based on what they see going on in that zone, in that economic area. So purely because of that, it's just you have to be more aware of fundamentals because they drive the market. I mean, the market can just turn on sixpence. Like if you just look at what happened with the Federal Reserve, they were saying they were going to hike rates, they're doing quantitative tightening, they were going to have 4 rate hikes were priced in this year. And then we had the bit of the stock market drop at the end tail end of last year. So they literally turned on the sixpence. They've become very accommodative. They've said that they're pretty much, the market's pretty much priced more than a 90% chance of rate cuts. They said they've stopped doing the quantitative tightening, and they're talking about unconventional measures, which is basically quantitative easing again. So literally the central bankers have, because of what's happened fundamentally in the markets, have just changed their view. So I mean, that just shows it's literally what they say will affect bond prices.
It's kind of annoying because we've got a semi-free market that's sort of liquid and works as it should, and then it's regulated and dictated by the central bank, and like you say, they can just change their policy, they can just decide they're going to do something, and it completely throws the real market sort of left and right, doesn't it?
Yeah, I mean, it's hard to say we've even got a normally traded free market anymore, because central bankers around the world seem to now be hell bent on keeping stock markets up, right? And that's literally their sole focus now. I mean, their original mandates, or maybe it still is a mandate, but they don't adhere to it, is price stability. And then somewhere down the line, that price stability goal changed to 2% inflation every year. So I mean, you can clearly see 2% inflation every year isn't a stable price, is it? It's an ever increasing price. And then now they have what they have, they call symmetric inflation targets. So that basically are saying we are gonna aim for higher inflation next year and the year after, because we had lower than 2% inflation the year before and the year before that. So
right.
the overall average will be, say, 2%. So again, it's just a way of allowing them to have even more inflation, inflate prices even more. And that's clearly going to be a launch pad for 0% interest rates and just, well, and them aiming to get very high inflation or get some sort of inflation. But the paradox is quantitative easing and their chasing of inflating asset prices, and that is exactly what it is. Mm. I mean, some people have tried to argue that there isn't inflation and they weren't doing QE to chase asset prices. But there's a guy that used to be work for our central bank in the UK called Danny Bunchfire, and he said in a statement on his Twitter not long ago that yes, we did basically do QE to increase asset prices. So there's no pretense about that. It's about increasing asset prices.
Right. Oh man,
yeah.
There's so many directions we can go with this, because there's the kind of conspiracy side of it as well. But just sticking with the trading side of things for a minute, how easy or difficult is it? Like if someone came to you and said, "Oh, I want to learn how to do that. Can you show me?" Yeah. Like, what do you say to people?
Well, trading, interestingly, is very difficult for a human to do because a human has pre-programmed ways of doing things that are the opposite of what is required to make money in a market.
Yeah.
So, for example, I'll explain this. This is an analogy I've used for people. Say you go to the supermarket one day and milk costs a pound. So milk costs a pound. You go the next day, it costs a pound. You go the next day, it costs a pound. And then you go the next day and it costs £1.50. So you might not buy milk that day waiting for it to go back to a pound, and then you go to the supermarket the next day and it's £2.50. So you're going to not buy something because it's going up in price. And so what you need to do in a trading market, things tend to have like trends. The markets will trend. So you'll have the sayings like the trend is your friend until the end, till it stops trending. But whilst something's trending, so say whilst the price is going up, it can be going down, it's just the converse will be true. The inverse will be true. But if something's going up, so you want to buy something. So in a market, say gold's going up and it's going up and it's going up, what you want to be doing and what would make you money more often than not would be buying it as it's getting more expensive. And just that simple concept goes against what you sort of as a rational thinking human want to do. And then what you actually do want to do is when something's going down in price, that's when you want to buy it. So you go to the supermarket, the milk's only 50p today, I'll buy double the amount and just leave some in my fridge because it'll last, for example. So you might think of doing that in the market. So say gold's going down. Oh, I'll buy some gold because it's going down. But that shows you the trend is down. It doesn't show you the trend down, but the trend could be going down. The trend is likely to be going down if it's right. going down. So that is then going to keep on going down. And then you've bought something, you're in a position that's then going to go offside. So that's the best way that I can explain why it goes against.
So that, yeah, yeah.
What you need to, yeah.
No, that makes total sense, because I had a go at doing this like 10 years ago.
Yeah.
I told you about it, and I really gave it a good shot. I had 4 screens. I noticed you got 6.
Yeah.
and I was doing US 10-year treasury bonds.
That was your problem.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I needed 2 more screens. That would have done it, right? And I was reading as many books as I could. I had a coach. I had about 5 grand in my trading account, and I was doing my best, but it just did my head in. I could not. The amount of hours I was spending on it each day. Like, how many hours, what's your strategy? Like, are you there all day or do you look at it once a day?
Well, no, I'm not. I try not to spend too long, because another interesting concept on markets is that price movement and charts they're all fractals. They're all fractals. So if you understand what I mean by fractal, is that you can sort of have a yearly chart, and it will be a series of peaks and troughs, ups and downs, trending upwards, trending downwards, for example. And then you can then zoom that in to have a monthly chart, And it'll be a series, again, a series of ups and down, peaks and troughs, trending up, trending down. You can then zoom that in again to, like, say, a 10-minute chart. And unless you actually know what the time scale of an individual chart is, you can't look at a chart and say what time scale it is. So working on that assumption, that logic, you can then trade a longer term time scale. So I'll often trade daily, weekly, 12-hour, 4-hour charts, because they're obviously, they are, people can trade short-term charts, but they're just trading a fractal of the longer-term chart.
Right.
So you can do less work by trading a longer-term time scale. So just, you're doing everything sort of in slow motion, as it were. Like, your moves are going to happen slower overall. I mean, you're going to go for bigger moves that are going to take longer time to play out, because you're looking at a daily chart. So each candlestick on the chart will be one day's data. So you'll be waiting for a certain level. Whereas you can zoom that in, and then you'll have a fractal of that and trade like an hourly chart, 10-minute chart, and day trade. But all you're actually doing is doing the set. You're just sort of giving yourself more work, aren't you?
Right.
You're literally just zooming in.
And this is where the emotional side of it is interesting, because if you're emotionally greedy and you're desperate and urgent to make money, like quick, for whatever reason, you're going to be more inclined to want to do like a really short term, minute by minute kind of thing. Whereas if this is how the emotions reflect it, isn't it? Because if you're more patient and you've got other stuff going on in your life and you've got other projects and you're happy to just look at the charts like once a day or once a week, you know, it all fits in with your whole life.
Exactly. You cannot force money out of a market. You can't find trades that aren't there. You have to wait till the trade sets itself up, and even then it's not guaranteed to be a winning trade, but it'll be a trade that you waited to set up based on your parameters, based on your strategy and what has proven to work for you over time. You can't squeeze money out of markets, and I think that maybe is why people do like to try and day trade and trade the zoomed in time frames, because they want to try and make money there and then that day and right now. And they're not where you are better off looking at the bigger picture, because ultimately you're doing the same thing but less work. You can't force money out of a market unless you take silly risks, which obviously in the longer run or even the shorter run you'll realize doesn't work.
What's your view? A couple of years back, the Bitcoin thing peaked, right? Or it rallied up to about
a couple of years back.
And like I noticed, I wasn't in it, right? But I noticed everyone around me, fucking people at the yoga studio, everything, was talking about buying Bitcoin. My housemates were talking about it. Like everyone was talking about it. And I knew enough to know that if everybody's talking about buying, that's probably a problem. So what's your view on that?
Yeah, well, that's true. This is how I can explain this to you so simply that you'll be like, oh, wow, that's exactly it. And you'll be shocked at how simple it is. So what happens is you have supply and demand of an asset or anything. So for it to keep going up in price, there has to be more demand for it than there is basically supply for it. So what happens is when you get to the saturation point of demand, where everybody wants it and everybody's bought it and everyone's bought it that's going to buy it and everyone's talking about it, then how do you generate any further demand to increase the price from that point? The answer is you can't, can you? You can't generate further demand beyond peak demand. So you might think this is great. Everyone's talking about it. Everyone's talking about it. It's gonna keep going up forever, or it's gonna double, or whatever you think it's gonna do. You're just forgetting the simple concept of where's the demand to make that gonna come from, on the basis that everybody is involved in it already. I literally had my hairdresser talking about it to the other hairdresser, and then I will just see people talking about it on Facebook constantly. And for full disclosure, before that run up, I was actually buying Bitcoin at under, I think it was under $3,000 before that run up.
Right.
And admittedly, I got out a lot earlier than I should have done. But before that run up, I was buying at $3,000. And it's documented on my Facebook. I'll send you a link to someone on my Facebook with the timestamp of the post saying who's got Bitcoin now at this price, because it had obviously gone up a lot at that point as well.
Mm.
But that's it. That's a simple concept. If everyone's talking about it, it can't keep going up because there's no one else left to buy, is there? So you've only got the people that are left to sell. So you sort of this it's sort of like there's another saying that you get in markets called buy on rumor, sell on fact.
Yeah.
So you can have the expectation of, say, a company releasing amazing profits, profit statement, or increasing revenue, or whatever it's going to do, or even being bought out. So what you do is, when you hear that rumor, when you hear that sort of filtering into the market, that's when you'll buy. So you buy up to it, and then when it's actually released as a statement and it's declared as fact, that's when all the people that were buying the rumor then sell the fact. So then the price, as soon as it's released, the price will then go down, not necessarily further down than it was before the rumor started, but it will give a lot of those gains that it gave into the run-up of the declaration of the fact.
It's very fascinating, isn't it, how human behavior gets mirrored in the markets, and the price is a sum total of all the market participants' sort of beliefs about what's going to happen, isn't it? Anybody that gets that, there's something magnificent about that, isn't there? It's very organic.
Yeah, I mean, markets, what markets are, in the short term, they are a voting mechanism, and in the long term, they're a weighing mechanism. So what that sort of means is, in the short term, it is basically the cumulative voting decisions of everybody in the market deciding where something should be priced or where it should be heading. But ultimately, the actual fundamentals of whatever the asset was, whatever the decisions they were making, will play out into the market. And then that will be the weighing process, and that will be where the market ultimately ends up in the long run. So say it's hard for me to use Bitcoin as an example because I'm a believer in Bitcoin going forwards, but you could say the voting mechanism was everybody basically bidding it up to 20K. And then the weighing mechanism was, when the reality set in, we then went down to about 3K, and then fair enough, we're 8K now.
Mm.
But it's sort of like you have the voting mechanism in the short term, and then you have like a weighing mechanism in the longer term where it reverts to maybe a more fundamentally driven price. But it is interesting seeing what markets do in the short term, because markets are doing some very funny things at the moment based on just government and central bank policy. And for me, I don't have a clue what's going on really long term fundamentally now. I mean, I'm interested in learning and researching into it and trying to understand, but so far as my actual trading is concerned, there's no way I can trade over any other way other than just on technical analysis, because there's too many crazy variables going on in the world these days.
Right.
Too much market intervention, too much talk of socialism, too much unconventional policy. I mean, negative interest, even zero interest rates were like a crazy thing, even back when I was trading bonds. How many years ago? 10 years ago.
Mm.
Over 10 years ago. But now we've had them in Europe for ages.
Just going back to something you said about it being a voting mechanism, and I've always said this, like, capitalism is the purest form of democracy, because you get to vote every second, every minute, with every pound you spend on what you want to happen, essentially, don't you? But it's hard for a lot of people to grasp that, because a lot of people are fixated on the conventional idea of democracy. You vote every 4 years, but waiting every 4 years to make a decision is a hell of a lot of friction on decision making, whereas the fluidity of the markets is, it, so to speak, a much better democracy. What do you think on that?
It maybe did used to be, but there are interventions in markets now, like quantitative easing, printing money, and then buying certain bonds and certain securities and certain whatever you want to buy to prop up the financial system. You could call it a hybrid. That's probably better, because it is to a certain extent a voting process. But then obviously then there's the external. I mean, you just have to look at Japan. After Japan had its great massive boom, back in, was it the 80s? And then they had their big massive bust, and then had been doing their own quantitative easing. And then what they had was what was called at the time their lost decade has just become their loss forever now. They're lost. They've never reclaimed their stock market highs. They've never generated any inflation, and their central banks own vast, vast swathes of their stock markets, bond markets, everything. It's a completely, fully manipulated system. So there is no vote in free market capitalism in markets there at all. And if anyone tries to tell me that isn't the way the whole world is going to end up, then I find it hard not to believe them, because there's only so many things that there's only so many tools that and things and processes that central banks can do across the world. And obviously Japan, being the only one in the situation it was the first to try and do everything it can, and has had chance to do anything it wanted to in a world that was generally doing okay. And they've still failed. So I can't see that the world as a whole, when the whole world then starts to not do so well, starts to fall under the weight of the fiat system, then how as the whole world, what they can do different to Japan? Because Japan couldn't do anything different when it was just Japan, and the rest of the world was doing okay. The rest of the world, but part lots of the rest of the world was doing okay over that period of time.
Now let me think though. I had a couple of different thoughts. During the financial crash, bankers on Wall Street were kind of blamed.
In 2008,
They were blamed for it, right? Now, what's your view on that as a financial person who's worked in the city? Is it your fault and people like your fault that there was a crash?
It was basically bankers' fault. Yeah, because the 2008 financial crisis was a crisis in subprime, and subprime. This isn't even in England. This is in America. So it's a subprime crisis in America. So what was happening was bankers were collateralizing mortgage-backed securities and selling, and then the ratings agencies, in collusion with the investment banks, were then rating these securities at higher risk, at a higher rating than they should have done. So they were then able to be bought by, say, pension funds or whoever, who could only invest in securities of a certain credit rating grade. So that created a demand for residential mortgages. So obviously, if there's a demand for residential mortgages because we can package them up and then sell them on to pension funds, then there is a demand for buying houses, because that's what you do with residential mortgages, isn't it? So if there's a demand for buying houses, that then obviously pushes up housing prices, which then encourages people to take on mortgages to then buy houses and make more money, then buy more houses. And then that then just that obviously those mortgages get packaged up and then sold on to pension funds. So basically, the error in that system lies with one, with the rating agencies for rating them as a, say, whatever they were. I can't remember what they're rating. Like, they were rating them as, like, they were obviously triple A, but they maybe I can't remember. It'll be a guess. Maybe they were B or triple double B or something like that. They were rating them, whatever they're rating it, but that was not a prudent thing for them to have done, because they obviously didn't stress test what would happen with happening a downturn in housing prices, which would obviously completely collapse these whole securities, practically make them worth like cents on the dollar, which he basically did, and then had to then be bailed out. And then so then what we have is finance. We have an investment bankers which created this conduit, along with the collusion from the rating agents, to then pass all this down to pension funds and to other people, and exported it around the world. What America did was it had a housing boom, a lot of equity and a lot of economic growth was benefited from by American Americans. But what they did, they exported a lot of these bonds around the world. So they exported their fraud to other countries around the world. So the whole world suffered, and not just America, whereas it was obviously the American housing markets and the people in there that were like releasing equity, spending, everybody was having a great time.
Yeah.
And they obviously didn't have to suffer a lot of the downside themselves, because I mean obviously we suffered in this country, and it wasn't, we're not the American housing market. So we had obviously Bear Stearns went down, Lehman Brothers obviously, we had our problems here. But what I will say, on whilst we're on this subject, the job of an investment banker and an investment bank, quite simply, is to use a complex process, over complex process, to transfer risk onto unsuspecting people, pension funds, entities, whatever.
Right.
So they can take the profit but pass the risk onto someone else. And that's very basically what it is. Because obviously everything's about risk and reward. So if you're going to profit, you need to obviously take risk. So, but then that will balance itself out in the end, unless you're smarter than anyone else. Mm. And I can tell you now, certain investment bankers and banks aren't smarter than other investment bankers and banks. It's they're not. They're all clever or stupid or however way you look at it, but they're all equal. Mm. So no investment bank is going to get an edge and become the world's best because it's got a guy who's so much smarter than everybody else. Mm. It's basically a zero-sum game, and they can only pass the risk onto other people. And that's why we have bailouts, because they do fuck up in the end, and do mess up in the end, and someone has to bail them out. So it's like that is their game, is use a complex, because let me tell you now, nothing in finance is that complex. The maths isn't complex. Taking man to say the moon, for example, or into space, or sending a probe to another planet, the maths is complex. You have to obviously take in to account lots of things. Whereas the maths in finance, I mean, we're just talking money. You add money, you take away money, you have a return, you have, do you know what I mean? It's not complex maths. So it has to be complexified. Complexified? Is that a word? Complicated.
Yeah.
So that you can pass the risk onto someone unwittingly. So
yeah, that makes sense.
So that is the summation of the financial crisis, and then obviously you get these banks. They're basically holding the economy to ransom. They're too big to fail. If you let us fail, the banking system collapses. All your people lose their money. It'll be pandemonium. So they just hold a country to ransom. And then not only is they too big to fail, they're too big to jail. So you have these guys. No one really goes to jail for anything ever. I mean, I think there was just that one French guy. He wasn't French. He worked at a French bank. He was English. He actually went to university in Nottingham. The guy that did then get extradited to Ghana, even though he'd lived in England since he was 12. That was the one trader who was hiding losses at, I think, StockGen. That he did go to jail and then got deported. But other than him, I can't think of another banker. I mean, obviously Bernie Madoff went to jail, but he was operating a Ponzi scheme. He wasn't a banker. But no investment bankers ever go to jail. I mean, the investment banking business model is let's commit fraud, and as long as the fines we have to pay for when we get found out for this fraud are less than the profits we make from the fraud, then that is a viable business model.
Yeah.
I mean, that's it.
Right. Yeah, it's, like the fines are just the cost of doing business, essentially.
Yeah, of course it is. Yeah. Yeah, that's exactly it. I mean, they manipulate everything just because they have to. They're chasing return, aren't they?
Yeah. And so in terms of bigger picture, oh, by the way, obviously Brexit is something that people talk about, but as a trader, does that bother you? Does that interest you? Is that part of your equation?
In all fairness, I'm very US concentrated, US like focused. Just because the US is a main driver for the world, and what they do affects all markets across the world. They're an important, obviously the US and China are obviously, between those two, dominate the world. So I the UK is, in the bigger scheme of things, relatively insignificant. So whilst I have views on Brexit and political views and things like that, and just overall class warfare views and things like that, so far as my actual trading, one, that would be a fundamental view anyway. So again, it wouldn't be something that I trade based on. And two, I don't really pay a lot of attention to UK focused stuff anyway, because it's relatively insignificant in the overall global picture.
So you're not going to be factoring in Bird in Yoga's economic advice then when you make your trading decisions?
Well, do you know what? I do love your the Bird in Yoga yoga joke thing. Your ongoing joke. But yeah, the Bird in Yoga, they are just representative of the people that you can't necessarily call them stupid, because on the whole they're probably not stupid. They're just brainwashed by smarter people, and smarter people with access to larger platforms to brainwash them with. Do you know what I mean? It's like it isn't their fault. I mean, they probably have a job where they have to concentrate on that, and then they probably have a life and maybe kids that they have to then concentrate. They don't have the time to sit back and look at the overall picture of things, the overall bigger picture. They don't have time to sit back and think about it. So they just see what comes up on their Facebook feed, what comes up in what they think is a trusted media source. They just see that, and then that just becomes their views and opinions. So it's not their fault. It's just, how can I say? It's the world we live in.
Yeah, it's better.
Everybody can't spend the time to become enlightened. They don't. You just don't have. I barely have time to do all the stuff that I need to do in my own life, let alone take on more things. So I know that other people can be in that situation, and they're just not going to understand. It's not their fault. It's just not their fault, is it?
Yeah, that's a much better perspective. That's a much more philosophical way of looking at things, like in terms of everyone's doing their best with the information they've got, aren't they? And like you said, if they got a minimal amount of time in order to understand the world, that's a much more positive view rather than...
Exactly. And then don't forget, any sort of alternative media or alternative opinion is demonized. So why is anybody going to want to open themselves up to any sort of... I mean, you see on my Facebook, I see in your Facebook, you have a view that's not popular because it's not mainstream, then you're just going to get attacked by people that just have no clue. So why would you want to open yourself to that? Some people literally just want to crack on with whatever their job is. I mean, that job becomes their world, and then their kids and their family outside of that and their friends become the rest of their world, and there is no space for anything else. There's no space for any bigger picture. So
yeah, I agree. Yeah, that's a good way of looking at it. So in terms of like society, and you know, you just touched on kind of censorship, alternative media, the climate at the moment, what's your views?
Well, we're in a mess. We're in a mess due to the monopolistic power of Facebook, Google, YouTube. Obviously YouTube's part of Google. We're just at the mercy of these guys now. I mean, it's not everybody knows that anyone on the right, or not maybe even the center, or that it just isn't left or extreme left, just will get deplatformed, demonetized, blocked, demonized, anything. I mean, they're just political entities now, as part of the one of the cogs of the global elite system. So far as censorship's concerned, I mean, until somebody decides they're going to have a sensitive a platform that isn't censored, or obviously there has to be certain censorship, there has to be certain levels, but what happens with Google and Facebook, they're deciding, they're making those decisions. And obviously we all understand that inciting people to commit violence or things like that, they obviously shouldn't be allowed. But just having different views that go against their view, you then will get demonetized or censored or deplatformed. And it just doesn't lean to a balanced debate in society, does it? So
It's going to
yeah,
be
but
very.
that's what happens. This that's sorry sorry yeah, that's what happens. That's why monopolies aren't meant to be allowed. So that's it for this very reason. So
It's going to be interesting to see how it all progresses because I feel like it can't go on like this. Like something has to bubble over or break. There has to be some tipping point with all this because we're going flat out, or it feels like towards the edge of
yeah.
a cliff or something. Something's got to
Well, that
change.
is it. That is it. We are traveling at 100 miles an hour. We basically jumped off a building, and we're traveling towards the ground. And we're just like, well, everything's fine. I'm not dead yet. Everything's fine. I'm not dead yet. Oh wow, even more time has passed, and I'm still fine. So maybe this will be okay. But ultimately, you're going to hit the ground, and you're going to die. And that's it.
This
That's the system as it is.
whole thing where if you're slightly conservative, you get called a Nazi and you can be treated however you want
Yeah,
and
you can have stuff thrown at you. You can be a war veteran, and you can have stuff thrown at you. You can be assaulted. Yet the if you're on the left, right, and to use a recent example, that Jussie Smollett guy, you can be on the left, and you can fake an assault on yourself, and you can't even be brought to trial for it because of the overwhelming political pressure. So I don't know if you know the details of that case, but yeah, I mean, he just faked a hate crime. He basically said two white guys, KKK guys, put a whatever over his head. I can't think what they do. Anyway, they did some very bad stuff to him, racial stuff, he claimed. But as it transpired, it was basically his two Nigerian brothers' training partners, PTs from his gym, that he hired to do it. So then he could then fake this whole story. And I mean, if something had happened on the right, if someone on the right wing had done such a thing, I mean, wow. I mean, it doesn't even bear thinking of, does it? The media circus that there would be. I mean, just look at that kid, that college kid that they took all of what was happening out of context with the Native
Oh
American,
yeah, all he
and
did is
it was
stand there and smile, and
yeah.
he's labeled,
Yeah, I mean, they just spun it differently. I mean, he's then suing various media outlets for millions and millions now, and obviously rightly so. But I mean, that there itself just shows that someone that is on the right and isn't doing anything can have a whole story spun against him, so that the point that he's literally widely hated amongst the country, and he's a school kid and done nothing wrong. So then someone on the left can completely actually make something up, be found out for it, be a full-grown adult in the public eye. Is an actor, is someone in there, do you know what I mean? He's not just a young school kid, and they completely get away with it because it's the left. I mean, there those two cases there, just highlight society at the moment, and it's not ideal, is it, to say the least.
I don't know if it's my perception, but there seems to be more I'm noticing more young conservative videos coming out, kind of pushing back. And I don't know if it's just because I'm subscribing to those pages on my news feed and stuff, but I really love it. There's a lot of I particularly love black conservatives and female conservatives because they can't be dismissed so easily, right? If it's a white male, it's easy to dismiss. Oh, you're just a white
Yeah.
supremacist, you're just a racist, or whatever.
Yeah, but that in itself is a sorry state of affairs, isn't it? Because you're basically saying that they have to be female or black or both to then us be able to give them any credibility, because we can't give a white male credibility. I mean, that alone, the statement that you've just said as a matter of just fact, without any sort of emotional response to, is a sorry state of affairs,
Oh
isn't
yeah,
it?
of course it is. Yeah, of course it is. But I'm noticing there seems to be, like with the market, when there's anytime there's a problem or an imbalance, it creates an opening, an opportunity for for an
Yeah.
influx of a new solution, doesn't it? And so it's weird, isn't it? Because the conservative censorship, it sort of creates a fresh opportunity. Like when you see these videos of people go conservatives on college campuses, like
Yeah.
interviewing liberals and just getting them to say dumb stuff. I mean, you don't even have to try.
Yeah.
You just basically stand there and let them
Yeah, of
talk,
course, yeah.
and it's almost like a new opportunity has opened up for this conservative sort of pushback, and I'm quite enjoying that. That's a bit of a
Yeah.
breath of fresh air, isn't it?
I can't see how it can get any traction though, because again, we've already spoke about the monopolies of the social media and the mainstream news media, again, and they're against these sorts of things. So there is no real traction. There'll be no organic normal pushback apart from obviously the ones you do get with the democratic process, such as voting in Trump, such as yellow vests in France, and such as our voting for Brexit. I mean, people, when they're given these choices to go against the established main the global elite, I would mainstream establishment, they then people will vote with their feet and go against it. But that's obviously only when it's taken to a ballot, and that's the only time these people get a say, isn't it? That's the only time democracy actually comes into play. And even then you'll get the whole monopolized social media and mainstream media doing everything they can do to try and persuade you into doing what they want you to do, and not doing what you want to do, as someone rebelling against the system. But then what is shown is that people still did vote in Trump, people still did vote for Brexit, and the yellow vest process are still going on every weekend, literally what, a half an hour's train ride from London, and they're never in the news. So yeah, so there is hope, but I mean, it's not going to be hard for them to control or just get rid of like the actual democratic process. So I mean, we do pretty much live in an Orwellian state. So
How do you deal in terms of like your friends and people that you interact with day to day? That's something I struggle with. Like, how do you do, like, do you, are you very picky about who is in your inner circle, or do you take a more easygoing approach? And like, because
yeah.
I struggle to find that balance.
Yeah, I mean, I don't I as part of being somebody on the right, and we watched that, was it Stefan Molyneux, what's his name, I'm not sure. We watched his video, and as someone who is on the right, you do tend to just be happier in your own political views, your own way of life, your own doing things, that you don't feel the need to have a problem with someone that has a different view. You do understand people have different views. You understand why you have your view. You even understand, as condescending as it might sound, that other person doesn't fully understand the situation, and that's why they have that view. So, like I was saying before, I don't have any problem with these people. Apart from obviously when they will try and have a big go at me, but I will never have a big go at them back. I will just have a reasoned argument with them, which again is practically pointless. But it's like I just can't. It's like when you have a dog who has a bad owner, and the dog then is aggressive. It's like you just can't blame the dog. It's the owner. Do you know what I mean? You can't blame these people. It's the people that dominate their way of thinking. So I don't. Yeah. So back to your original question. Yeah. No, I don't. I'm sure some of my friends may have different views, but again, I mean, I've been talking to you now. I'm quite good at explaining and putting across the overall system, overall view. So a lot of my friends, I probably would have talked around to like a more real a realist version of the world anyway. So it's not like I don't really, there isn't anyone I can think of that because of something I've told them about how the world is, and then just, oh, they're not my friend anymore, or I've fallen out of them, or I had a big dis. Do you know what I mean?
Oh man,
I
try going
mean,
to yoga.
well, yeah. I should try going there, shouldn't I? I should try and do some preaching and yoga. But
Don't bother to let me save you the time. Don't bother.
yeah, I still don't even know if you do. Do you actually go to yoga? Do you actually go to yoga, or is it just all a metaphor?
No, I used to do a lot of circus stuff
Okay.
and a lot of physical activities like dance and yoga, and I teach handstands, and so I kind of accidentally ended up immersed in that world. And when I got
Yeah.
into it was just the physical activities that I was interested in, like, just I thought
Yeah.
it'd be cool to be able to do cool shit. I didn't really, that was pre-Trump, right? And I didn't
Yeah.
really understand liberalism and the social justice warriors and the radical feminists.
Oh
I
yeah,
didn't
virtue signaling.
I was naively strolling into a leftist like hellhole, you know, lair.
Yeah.
And then once Trump came around, it's like all these maniacs around me suddenly,
didn't it?
Yeah, they sprung into life and they turned into, you know, hissing, spitting, septic social justice warriors. And
well, that's not necessarily anything particularly bad about Trump. That's just because Trump is going against the established corporate America, and they're the neocons basically. So he then has to be demonized by every media outlet and every social media outlet that there is. So that is going to influence people's decisions. I mean, how can so many people in this country protest and hate Trump when hardly anybody did really protest against Bush and the Iraq wars and things like that? I mean, it just shows you that it's just all ludicrous. But don't forget, a lot of protesters are professional protesters, and they just buy into a lifestyle. It's just something for them to go and do. Whatever people are protesting against or for, that's what they go and do. It's just a lifestyle for them, isn't it? It's just something to do. It's a hobby.
Yeah,
it's a hobby for these guys.
Yeah, that's right. They get irate about certain issues, and that's like you say, that's where they get their kicks. That's where they feel significant.
It's just the fun. It's like young kids might go on lads' holidays, or you go to a festival, or you do whatever you do in groups of people that do stuff that you guys like to do. These guys like to go and protest. They'll have lots of friends there, and they'll just have a laugh, and they'll. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah,
that's the way I see a lot of it.
I think I'm going to adopt your way of looking at things. You seem to have like a higher level, sort of slightly more detached philosophical view on the way that other people behave, which is that's better, really, because
it definitely is better.
Because you avoid getting caught up in the anger and all that.
Well, exactly. You don't want to just be living there in the trenches, do you? Fighting and not seeing what's the bigger picture, do you? It's just pointless. The older I've got, the more I've gone on in life, I've realized that there is no real conflict other than conflict that you do cause. I mean, the things that you could conflict against, you probably can't do anything to affect anyway. So you're best off just understanding the whole situation, and then just not letting things bother you. I mean, you can only create stress yourself in your own head. I mean, I say to people a lot, like, they'll have something bad will happen to them, or something bad will be happening to someone else, and I'm just like, look, there's a kid in Syria with no food, electric, that's getting bombed, his brother and sisters are probably dead, and he's okay. Do you know what I mean? He's not thinking of killing himself, he's just cracking on with life. And if you get some food today, he's going to be as happy as anybody. I mean, everything's about your relative perspective. So you just have to look at, especially living in this country, living in England, being born in England. I mean, also, life can be easier if you're white. Life can be easier if you're male. You basically won the lottery with these things. So you can't beat yourself up or get involved emotionally with things that are gonna just bring down your quality of life, because there's no point, is there? You only live once. You don't want to waste your life being unhappy and angry, do you?
Yeah.
Because of various things that you can't affect.
Yeah, completely.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
By the way, where
do you attribute? You've got a rational outlook on life. Was your parents that way? Was your dad the same?
Well, ironically, I think my view on life has come from basically a very turbulent upbringing. Like, I was thrown out of home by my mother when I was 17, and she, like, for want of a better word, is a lunatic. She's got no friends or family that speak to her. She's been married 4 times. This lady, my mother, has literally left a wake of destruction through her life with so many people. So, so like, my whole upbringing was very difficult because of this. Obviously then living on my own from 17 was difficult as well, because I'm on my own at 17. So I basically had to deal with a lot of stuff in my life that has then just made me realize that A lot of the other stuff that happens to me in my life, or people's views, and a lot of things that have happened to other people that's a lot worse than what's even happened to me. It just puts things in perspective, really. And that's where it comes from. It hasn't come from, it has come from an influence from my parents, but not the influence that you might think, with them basically teaching me exactly what my views on life. I feel like I've just grown up in a battleground, in constant conflict. So now that I'm in control of my own life, because I'm an adult, I can actually choose to not have that conflict. So
Were
that's what I do.
you always ambitious from that age?
Well, the thing is, I've always been quite intelligent. As like a kid in primary school, I was told by like an independent education assessor that I was like the smartest kid he'd ever seen in primary school, because I could do like algebra and stuff. And I just remember, I have this memory of probably being about, I can't remember how old I was, maybe 7 or 8 in primary school, and this like big adult assessor person like sh what sh asking to shake my hand in primary school and in front of the kids and everything and teachers, because I just want to shake your hand because you're literally the smartest kid I've ever met. And then following that, I got a scholarship to go to a really good school, which was purely based on academic ability, because it was a private school, but I got a scholarship, so it was paid for, because I got one of the highest marks out of the thousands of people that took the exam. So it's sort of, I guess you could call it ambition, but it's just, I've just tried to use my intelligence that I've had throughout my life to my benefit. And then what I consider as my benefit is being able to work as little as I can to then have enough money to do what I need to do, if you know what I mean. It's like I don't subscribe to the whole work 60 hours a week, earn as much money as you can, burn out by the time you're 40 or 50, have an unhealthy life, have no relationship with your kids because you're not there, have failed marriages because you're not there. And I don't really subscribe to all of that. I'd rather have less money than I am capable of earning, but have a lot of time to spend like with my 2 daughters or my friends or family, or doing a job that I want, like doing, like the hen party stuff. I set up a business doing that because I enjoy doing it. It's a laugh. I do it with my mates. It's fun. I'd rather do something like that. Yeah. So that is it, really. So I suppose it was not like I'm ultra ambitious and I've driven myself to do what I do. I mean, I've just had an ability to achieve what I've been able to achieve. And even then, I do in my own mind know that I have seriously underachieved what I was capable of. But like I said before, I mean, life's thrown a lot of things in my way, so it was always difficult for me to get myself through uni, to get myself a job, to get myself to where I've got to on my own at 17, after leaving a battleground of a home life,
How old are you
since
now?
it started. I'm 35 now,
Okay.
35.
Yeah, I'm
But yeah.
36, so about the same.
Yeah.
Are you somebody who has like really clear long-term goals, or do you sort of take it as it comes?
Yeah, I do have long-term goals, and that's basically just to be rich, really, just the usual. Not because I have an obsession or infatuation with money, just because I understand the concept that money just make life easier and less stressful. So if I can then provide for my kids, make sure they've got like a leg up in life, and that's it, that's the motivation, really. So that, and to live a longer, healthy life by not being stressed.
Who are the people you listen to or watch or follow or read?
To be honest, a lot of the people I'll listen to are they're just financial market analysts, really. So they're not really, it's not really anything philosophical. I mean, I have started to listen to a couple of those guys recently, because if I'm being completely honest with you, one of my highest rated financial analyst guys I listen to was telling me that he'd been listening to this guy and not been listening to financial stuff a bit. So I thought, okay, then I like this guy. I'll see what he's been listening to. And that sort of stirred me in that direction a little bit.
Who's that?
So even that. Oh, who was it now? He's a really famous American guy. I'll have him on my thing. Let me have a look at my computer.
You're not on about Jordan Peterson, are you?
No, it isn't Jordan Peterson. No, it is. Let me find him. It is. Let me find him. Oh, Rolo Tomasi.
Oh, okay. I don't know that name.
The Rational Male. It's called Rolo Tomasi, the Rational Male.
Okay.
And he goes on a lot of like red pill, blue pill stuff. And like he basically, obviously it's using a matrix analogy. Like he's just, like he's taking the red pill and he's just more enlightened. It's similar to how I am really. Maybe that's why I did start listening to him, because you just understand the bigger picture. You understand, like, obviously the red pill and the matrix, you're taken out of the matrix and you see the bigger picture, don't you?
Mm.
So it's a lot of that. But yeah, you'll definitely like him. He's definitely a similar sort of ilk to the other people that I know that you listen to.
Okay.
But I'll send you the link anyway. Rolo Tomasi, the Rational Male, is called.
Okay.
But yeah, his things are often a bit lengthy. They do go on, because he just do a podcast, like a radio show sort of thing, and he will just be talking for quite a while. But But yeah, so it was really him. And obviously then once you click, you know how YouTube is, once you click on one of these things, another one comes up. Yeah. And then I think you sent me a link to that Stefan guy, Stefan. So I listened to some of his things. But my actual philosophies that I've had, my philosophical views that I've had aren't from any sort of outside influence. They're literally just homegrown in my own brain due to my own existence, basically.
So. Sounds like you've got a good balance. You've got a good balance between your own sort of internal sort of sorting and sifting of what makes sense to you, and also influences from other people as well. But you know, a balance between the two.
Yeah, I feel that's how I feel like in myself. I feel like I do have a balance. I feel like that's how I am. I mean, it is born from conflict, so I don't necessarily like think it's a good path for someone to take to get to a more chilled out version of themselves. But I mean, I do have a certain way, I guess, that is just what I mean. We are basically a product of our environment, aren't we? So,
At what point did you get into bodybuilding and getting in shape? Were you always athletic?
To be honest, I was. Yeah, I did. I used to do. I would join an athletics club when I was a kid, and I did athletics, and then I played rugby at school, and then I wasn't allowed to play rugby at school because I was too good at athletics, so I had to just do athletics. So I did that, and then I did boxing for a lot of years as well, which is a lot of fitness. I sort of got into that because of the fitness, because I was fit. So obviously, I was then, because that's a lot of boxing, and then it sort of like didn't go so well, obviously, when I was working trading in London, because obviously the light doesn't really fit into the lifestyle. I was getting unhealthy. I wasn't very physically fit anymore. So then I just decided, right, I'm getting out of this. And then now I will say a lot of my motivation for my training now, I wouldn't call it bodybuilding, but just training is just the hemp party entertainment work that I do at the weekends, just because I obviously have to keep a certain level of okay appearance for that. So I do always say to people, I mean, I don't really enjoy going to the gym. I've done it for so many years, for so long. It's like, I don't really enjoy it, but I understand it's just part of my job now. That's that really.
What do you enjoy more, butlering or life drawing?
I haven't done many life drawing ones, to be honest. I do prefer butlering. It's just more interactive, it's just more interactive, basically. So I do prefer those ones. I find the life drawing ones are a bit, they're just not quite the same. There's not the same amount of interaction. It's just a bit different, isn't it?
Yeah, I'm kind of the other way around. I always used to I always felt like I didn't have enough games with Butler in, and like I guess you need to have a whole list of stuff you can do from one thing to the next. Is that how you do it? Do you go from one game to the next?
Well, that is true. I mean, I do have like a list as long as your arm of various different drinking games, various different games, all sorts of things, ways to kill time in those 2 hours, and keep them entertained. I mean, I've just done it for so many years now. I literally have done it not long after coming back from London, because one of my friends, he was doing it for another agency, and he said, "Oh yeah, come and do this with me." I was like, "Oh, okay then." And I was like, "Oh, this is why I just set up my own business." And that's where that came from. But yeah, I just did it for so long. It's like anything. You just become experienced at it, and you just know what you're doing, don't you? So you have more. Yeah. So it's never. There's never any gap where it's like, I don't really know what to do now, sort of thing. So yeah, it just doesn't really happen.
I only recently started transitioning into more of a business just this last 6 months. I was for I've been doing it about 6 years just on my own. I started off working for agents and stuff, and eventually just started getting my own bookings. And then recently, I noticed I was like turning down a lot of work, and I thought, oh fuck, I might as well just start giving the
Get
work
some
out to other
guys,
guys and
yeah.
stuff. And now a mate of mine who's really good on marketing and sales, we're partnering up, so he's going to sort of do the business side of things, and we're going to sort of expand and into more of a business agency kind of thing. So that's sort of what I've been focused on the last couple of months.
Yeah, well, that's really good then. If you're actually getting more work than you could do, and you're not actually paying for advertising, it's just the client list or word of mouth, whatever you build up over time, and that's obviously fantastic, because obviously any business, a large part of it's either monetary or time expenditure is advertising, isn't it? So I know that mine is. So yeah, so if you're doing okay without the advertising, just add some advertising in, and then you're gonna be flying, aren't you? So
I'm looking forward to it, because I'm starting, like, I've always enjoyed it, but I'm starting to get to that point now, like, I don't want to do it forever, so I'm starting to change into that mindset now.
yeah, I do know that feeling. I am aware that I am getting on a bit, but reckon I've got a couple of years maybe left in me, but hey, see how it goes.
Hey, it's been good talking to you, Daniel. I've enjoyed it. It was only recently that I kind of twigged that we're actually pretty similar minded, so.
Yeah, I think it is pretty apparent from my Facebook page that we are definitely similar minded. I do like to cause a bit of a kerfuffle on my social media.
I'll try and stop giving Birdin Yoga, who doesn't actually exist. She's a sort of fictional character, just
Oh well,
accumulation of.
you have burst that bubble now, haven't you? Because I you could realistically be a person, but I did obviously know she wasn't saying all the things that she was saying, but I knew she could have been based on a current character.
I think it's a way for me to sort of vent my irritation at rather than a real person, just vent it at a fictional character who does represent real people, but without me getting into arguments with an actual person. So it's just an outlet for me in a
Yeah,
way.
it is a funny way of doing it. It is an entertaining way of doing it, and that is that we live in an entertainment based world, don't we? So if you can find a funny, interesting, or exciting way of getting a point across, it's obviously a better way to do that, isn't it?
Like, comedy is qu performs quite an important role in terms of, like, comedy. When you
Communication
make
of.
fun of things, it breaks down people's oh, what am I
Yeah.
trying to say? People's inconsistencies in their point of view, because that's really what making fun of something is, isn't it? It's pointing
Yeah.
out the conflicts
Yeah, of
in
course. Yeah. I mean,
people's.
they do say obviously a lot of truth is said in jest, isn't it? So
So
yeah, that's where that comes from.
good stuff. Well, I'll let you get back to the markets.
Oh yeah, well, it's been over an hour, hasn't it?
We've been going
Yeah,
well. I got speed
long
awareness
it's
course now.
flown by that, hasn't it? Yeah, cool. All right, well, good luck with your speed awareness and your Tinder date as well.
Thank you. Thanks.
Yeah, look forward to seeing how that goes. And then yeah, well, I will sort out a webcam if you want to have another chat again in a few months or so.
Definitely. We'll do that. I quite often come back sort of every so often and have guests on again. So we'll talk again in a few months.
Yeah, cool. All right then, Ben.
Nice
Well,
one.
have a great day.
All right, you
I'll
too.
speak to you soon.
Cheers,
Bye.
then. Bye.